Hi everyone. Microorganisms in water and their importance on a brief note we are going to discuss in this video. Let's begin. The water is going to be the most valuable natural resource, in which 97% is going to be the marine water. And the remaining 3% of the fresh water is available in the lentic, that means where lakes, tanks, ponds are going to be involved. And the lotic, where rivers, streams, canal systems are going to be included. And the little quantities of water or fresh water is also present in some glaciers as a groundwater, etc. And we know that the water is going to be essential for all types of organisms, including the microorganisms. So here the terminologies of a few different types of water. The first one is a potable water, the clean water or drinking water, which is free of all objectionable materials like pathogens, taste, then odors, color, toxins, radioactive material, organisms, oils, gases, etc. are going to be considered as potable water. That means the water that is being used as a drinking water and for domestic usage is being termed as potable water. Then fresh water is going to be non-salt or non-sea water is going to be the fresh water. Then polluted water, anything that makes it non-potable is going to be called as polluted water. And the terminology of sewage water also comes under the polluted water. But the sewage water is going to be the water where the community waste or garbage that Mother Nature and we dump into the sewers or lands is going to be called as sewage water. The study of these microorganisms and their communities in water environment is going to be called as aquatic microbiology or simply water microbiology. All types of water are going to be associated with a variety of microorganisms as water provides an environment for them to survive and function. So these microorganisms in water have some positive aspects such as a recycling of nutrients, decomposition of organic matter, then maintenance of ecological balance. So these are all going to be considered as positive aspects of the presence of microorganisms in water. At the same time, you are also having some sort of a negative aspects because of the presence of microorganisms in water. They are going to be the eutrophication, then polysaprobic state, then BOD, that is biochemical oxygen demand, and reduction in water quality. So these are all going to be few negative aspects of this microorganism presence in the water. Then the important factors which are influencing the association of microbes in water are going to be the first one, mixing and movement of nutrients or amount of the organic matter that is going to be present. For example, if more nutrients is going to be present in water in the form of an organic matter, the greater amount of the bacteria is going to be present in. Then at the same time, oxygen. So aerobes are going to mostly thrive in the oxygen presence, and anaerobic bacteria can be seen more in number when more organic decomposition is going to occur in the water bodies. Then coming to the temperature, low temperature are not conducive to rapid growth, whereas a higher temperatures result in increased bacterial numbers in the presence of sufficient organic matter. So the temperature of the surface waters varies from near 0 degrees in polar region to 30 to 40 degrees in equatorial region. So depending upon the temperature of the water also, the microorganism flora is going to differ. More than 90% of the marine water temperature is below 5 degrees centigrade. And the microorganisms do occur in the hot spring ranges from 75 to 80 degrees. That is the best example is Thermus aquaticus, which is going to grow at the temperature of 70 to 72 degrees centigrade. And some microorganisms also associated with the geothermal vents in Pacific Ocean and are capable of growing at 250 degrees centigrade. So these are the things that are going to be seen in the factor of temperature. Then moving to the waste products, if more the waste products are going to be dumped in the water bodies, then obviously there will be more growth of the organisms, that is especially microorganism, because of the enrichment of the nutrients, all the waste in its water body. Then coming to the pH, The aquatic microorganisms in general can be grown at pH 6.5 to 8.5. But the pH of the sea that we know is 7.2 to 8.5 as the salt concentration is high. Then the optimum growth of most of the marine species is going to be obtained on the medium just at a pH of 7.2 to 7.6 near to the neutral. The lakes and the rivers may show a wider range in pH depending upon the local conditions. Then coming to the light, most forms of aquatic life depend directly or indirectly upon the metabolic process of photosynthetic organisms. That means in most aquatic habitats, the primary producers are going to be the algae that we know, and their growth is going to be restricted to the upper layer of water through which light can penetrate. Then moving to the next types of water, so that means, as I told you, depending upon the type of water and the atmosphere, temperature, everything, again it is going to differ. For example, in the surface water like streams, lakes, shallow wells, we are going to have the opportunities for contamination or many bacteria are present. Whereas the water from the deep driven wells, water has undergone efficient filtration in order to reach the surface strata. So that's how the surface is going to have the more bacteria when compared to the shallow waters. So hence this only contain a few number of bacteria, rich water which is going to be driven deep wells. Then hydrostatic pressure, so nothing but the barophiles here we are going to discuss, because the one which tolerates the hydrostatic pressure are going to be called as barophiles. And the hydrostatic pressure affects the chemical equilibrium, so that means the lowering the pH of a seawater, which change in the solubility of nutrients and the water in its liquid state at high temperature and pressure. Now the hydrostatic pressure increases with the depth at the rate of 1 atmospheric pressure for 10 meters. So as you move down to the sea level, so obviously you are going to have the more pressure. So the certain type of barophilic microorganisms are going to be seen at a depth of 1000 to 10,000 meters where pressure is greater than 100 atmospheres. So that's why we call them as barophiles. Then coming to the salinity, so it depends upon the salinity of mainly in the marine waters. So the degree of the salinity in natural water ranges from zero in fresh water to saturation in the salt lakes. And the concentration is going to vary between 33 to 37 grams per kg. And you can find the majority of the salts are going to be seen in the sea waters like chlorides, sulfates, carbonates of sodium, carbon, potassium, calcium and magnesium. So the organisms which are going to grow in these marine conditions or high alkaline conditions is going to be called as halophiles, and these halophiles are going to grow better at a concentration of 2.5 to 4%. And who are these from lakes and rivers are salt sensitive, and they do not grow at a salt concentration of more than 1%. Okay, then moving to the turbidity factor, which is influencing the microorganisms in water. So as I told you that there will be some sort of a variation in the surface waters and sea waters, and the Adriatica Sea is a clear at great depth, whereas some near shore rivers are often turbid. And the suspended material responsible for turbidity is going to include the particles of minerals that were originated from the land, and detritus, predominantly particulates, organic materials such as cellulose, hemicellulose and the chitin fragments, and even the suspended microorganisms. And the turbidity of water is going to influence the penetration of light, which in turn affects the photosynthetic zone. So these are the few factors which are having the influence of the microbial growth in the water bodies or water systems. Then moving to the what are the microorganisms that are going to present in the water. A large number of microorganisms are going to be seen in different kinds of the water. So especially bacteria, fungi, algae, virus, protozoa and some sort of nematodes. Or helminths, their eggs cyst, even saprophytic and pathogenic bacteria can also be seen in the water or aquatic environment. And the typical of a microbial population is going to differ in different type of the water habitats, such as unpolluted water is going to have some different flora, polluted one is going to have the different flora, and the marine waters is going to have some other different flora. So let's have a glance of all the types of microorganisms that are going to be present in different water habitats. For example, if we check the unpolluted water, these are the microorganisms that we can see in them, like Actinomycetes, yeast, Bacillus spores, Clostridium spores, cellulose digesters, autotrophic, Euglena, and Paramecium. When you come to the polluted water, that means where the water is going to be getting polluted either by the chemicals or the sewage, then we are going to have the finding of these microorganisms in such water, like coliform bacteria, Escherichia coli, desulfur vibrio species, Clostridium species, fecal streptococci, protozoans, mainly cystworms, cyanobacteria, and enteric viruses. Then moving to the marine water, so obviously we know that this marine water is going to possess the halophilic microorganisms, then cyclophilic microorganisms, which can tolerate or grow at low temperatures, and then diatoms, then dinoflagellates, mold spores, pseudomonas species, foraminiferans, and luminous microbes. So these are the few microorganisms which are going to found in different water habitats. Now, according to a heterophilic plate count, an accurate assessment is going to be done where we are going to have a bacteria like mainly gram-negative bacteria. Here we can see like Pseudomonas, Aeromonas, Klebsiella, Flavobacterium, Enterobacter, then Citrobacter, Serratia, Echinetobacter, Proteus, Alcaligenes, Moraxilla, etc. Apart from these bacteria, water also contains diversified microorganisms grouped under algae, fungi, protozoa, then rotifiers, worms, and myxobacteria too. The commonly associated algal forms or genera are going to be the Chlamydomonas, Volvax, then Pantorian, Chlorella, Spirogyra, Diatoms, Nostoc, Anabina, Oscillatoria, Cytonema, then Diatoms, etc. Okay, so these are going to be the certain members of the Phycomycetes can also be seen here. That means the members of Phycomycetes are generally associated with water, and some genera belonging to Deuteromycota are also commonly seen in the water. The unicellular organisms like protozoa are very common in the water, and these protozoa breathe with oxygen dissolved in the water, that we know. The benthamic or benthic biological film contains representatives of Sarcodina colorless flagellate, and then ciliated infusoria, which we call ciliata, and the sucking infusoria, where is Suctoria. So then coming to another rotatoria is a representative of rotifiers of the animal kingdom and have more complicated structures than protozoa. These are going to be the aerobes. That means these rotifiers are going to be the aerobes and are sensitive to oxygen deficiency. Rotifiers are sensitive to the changes that is going to occur in the active reaction of the medium, and these are going to be the indicator organism characterizing the quality of water. Lower crustaceans are freshwater dwelling organisms. Example, Cyclopis and Daphania are the best examples of these rotifiers. Okay, then moving to the next one, the important physiological groups of microorganisms in aquatic habits that we come to see. Here you can see the physiological group photoautotrophs, photoheterotrophs, chemoheterotrophs, and chemolithotrophs. And the examples of the genera that they are going to possess is Chlorobium, Chloroheptaon, Chromatium, Pelidecton, and Thiodecton, and Thiopodia are going to be the physiological groups of photoautotrophs. Then photoheterotrophs are Chloroflex, Heliobacterium, Heliothrix, Rhodocyclus, Rhodomicrobium, Rhodopseudomonas, and Rhodospirillum. Then chemoheterotrophs are going to be Blastobacter, Colobacter, Flexibacter, Flexithrix, and then Gemobacter, Hypomicrobium, Leothrix, and Separiotylus. Then chemolithoautotrophs, Bagiota, Gallionella, Thioplora, Thiothrix, and Thiovalen. So these are the few important physiologic groups of microorganisms that we see in aquatic habitats. Then moving to the microorganisms in freshwater. So the aquatic environments are going to be free of any pollutants that support less microbial population and are going to be called as oligotrophic. Okay, under natural conditions, all freshwater aquatic bodies are going to be oligotrophic only. And these waters are going to contain the what we call as usual saprophytes, that is soil saprophytes such as Micrococcus, Flavobacterium, Chromobacterium, Bacillus, Proteus, Pseudomonas, Leptospira, etc. And the certain psychrophilic forms belonging to the genera Escherichia, Aeromonas, Alkaligene, and Arthobacter, Corynebacterium, Klebsiella, Micrococcus, Streptococcus vibrio, then Clostridium, etc. can be seen here, often reported from this freshwaters. The unique bacteria found in the freshwater are going to be the prosthetic bacteria, which are going to be known as Anachalomicrobium or Prosthicomicrobium. Is going to be considered as a unique bacteria that we can find in the fresh water. Other prosthetic bacteria are going to be of what we call as a Colobacter and Hippomicrobium are also going to be the prosthetic bacteria that we find in the fresh water. And several algae, sheath bacteria such as a Leptothrix, Crinothrix, Chlorothrix are going to be found growing on the surface of rocks and logs near the shore. And in the aphotic zone of lake or pond, the anaerobic bacteria of the family Rhodospiralaceae are going to be present and produce H2S and the methane gases in high quantities. So these are the few things that we have to know about the microorganisms which are going to be present in the fresh water. So here you can see the different zones of a pond or a lake. So generally the lake or ponds are going to have the four regions. Okay, and here you can see this is going to be the topmost layer called as littoral zone. And here is a limnatic zone and then profundal zone and benthic zone. So the littoral zone is going to be situated along the seashore, which has considered the rooted vegetation. So here you can see the rooted vegetation and include the regions where the light penetrates to the bottom. So that is going to be the one. Then coming to the limnatic zone is situated in an open area after littoral zone. So here you can see the limnatic zone, which is just below the littoral zone, which is going to be determined by the light compensation level, that is depth of effective light penetration. So here you can see few microorganisms. Then coming to the profundal zone, so this is the profundal zone, just beneath the limnatic zone in the deeper region of the open waters where the photosynthetic decreases, that means the photosynthesis is going to decrease because of the low penetration of the light and progressively due to the low penetration of the light, you don't have the photosynthesis here. But we can see the purple and green sulfur bacteria in this location. Then the last zone that we are going to see is the benthic zone. So here the benthic zone is going to be considered as the deepest zone composed of soft mud, and they are going to be present at the bottom of the lakes and the ponds. So here you can see the desulfur vibrio, Clostridium, methane bacteria, such type of the microorganisms can be seen at the benthic zone. Then coming to the fresh streams, so streams obtain majority of the nutrients from the flow of inorganic and organic material from the surrounding terrestrial systems or lakes or ponds. So to major extent, the microflora reflects the immediate terrestrial conditions, including the effects of agriculture and industrial practices. Then coming to the microbes in the polluted water. So the general pollutants in the aquatic system generate from sewage and drainage waters. The fecal matter is the basic source for the abundance of bacterial diversities like E. coli and related enterobacteriaceae members like fecal streptococci and the species of intestinal clostridium are going to be present in abundance. And in the polluted water, there are going to be of large amounts of organic matter from the sewage. So obviously, you are going to have the content of more heterotrophic microorganisms. In addition to this, we can also find some sort of saprophytes which are going to be derived from soil such as Spirillum, Vibrio, then Micrococcus, Bacillus, Mycobacterium, Sarsina, yeast, molds are also going to be seen here. And coming to the at the bottom of the polluted water body, diversified anaerobic bacteria are also going to be seen, like Clostridium, Desulfo Vibrio, that is going to exist and decompose the organic matter. The total number of microbes per ml reaches 2 million, which is going to be called as polysaprobic condition. That means if the microorganisms in this polluted water under the anaerobic conditions, it is going to reach in the millions per ml, then we call that condition as polysaprobic condition. Under certain conditions, the polluting organism multiply rapidly and consume most of the oxygen, causing increased BOD, that is biochemical oxygen demand. And due to this unavailability of oxygen, a layer of dead organisms, mud and the slit is going to accumulate at the bottom, and anaerobic bacteria such as Clostridium, Desulfo Vibrio will also flourish and produce the gases like H2S, etc. And these gases, that is H2S, methane, are going to mix with the metals that are going to present in that water body like lead or iron and give a precipitate which makes the mud black and the water poisonous. So this is what we have to remember regarding the polluted water. Then moving to the microbes in marine water. So the marine water is going to be highly in salt concentration, and only halophilic organisms are going to survive. That means the one which grows in the high salt concentration are going to survive in this marine water. Since the temperature is low, most of them are going to be saprophytic. I told you as we move down that the majority of the marine bodies are going to have a 5 degree centigrade temperature. So saprophytes can also be absorbed here. Then coming to the diatoms and protozoans are going as dinoflagellates or important components in the food chain of this marine water bodies. And in the oceanic zone, that is the ocean zone, that is offshore, we can find the photosynthetic organisms such as diatoms and protozoa. In the littoral zone or along the shoreline, most of the marine microorganisms are going to be found. Whereas in the benthic zone, that is at the bottom zone, we can find some unusual types of microorganisms that you are going to see. So this is about the microorganisms in marine water. Then the microbes in potable water, that is our water suitable for drinking and domestic use and free from disease causing microorganisms is going to be potable water. Generally, the drinking or the potable water is going to be free of any microorganism, but there may be a chance of gaining the entry of bacteria such as E. coli, Streptococcus faecalis and Clostridium perfringens into our potable water, and their presence is going to indicate the status of water quality and gives warning signals for the treatment and recalibration of the water bodies. So coming to the significance of water microorganisms. So until now we have discussed the different types of the microorganisms that are going to be present in the different kinds of the waters. Now we are going to discuss about what is the significance of water microorganisms, why we are supposed to read about these water microorganisms. So coming to the first point, the microflora of a natural aquatic body is less dense due to oligotrophic conditions. And this microflora is involved in the decomposition of plant, animal materials that were added to the water, and thus it is going to help in the recycling of our nutrients. That is the first positive aspect. Then the second one is going to be when the nutrient content, especially nitrogen and phosphorus, is going to be increased as a case of fertilization, and the specific microflora dominates and suppresses the other microflora. And mostly blue-green algae forms dominant, resulting in the algal blooms that restrict the use of water for transport, etc. The next point of significance of microorganisms in water. In water polluted with sewage and industrial effluents, the BOD, that is biochemical oxygen demand, and COD, chemical oxygen demand, contents are going to be decreased and pave the way for anaerobic conditions, where heavy pollution leads to dominance of anaerobic phototrophic organisms, and such water bodies need great efforts for remediation. So we cannot easily clean up these water bodies. The sewage polluted waters contains a number of human pathogenic organisms. When used or not treated, it becomes a major source of waterborne diseases. So for example, if you take the cholera, hepatitis, typhoid, poliomyelitis, and amoeba. So these are all the best examples of waterborne diseases. So that's all about the different types of microorganisms in water and the significance of the presence of these microorganisms in the water. Thank you.